I am already clearing one doubt, right? So 146 neutrons and 95 protons, and it says alpha particle is, it's decaying by emitting alpha particle. Kiraz, alpha particle has, what is the mass number of alpha particle?
Mass number of?
Alpha particle?
1, 4.
It's 4 and 2. Atomic number is 2, mass number is 4.
And helium,
it means it has 2 protons plus 2 neutrons. So alpha particle, if you want to visualize it, you can visualize it like this.
It
is 2 protons and 2 neutrons.
That is helium.
So this is called helium.
And 2 electrons.
Yes. Alpha particle is the helium nucleus. So Firas, alpha particle has how many protons inside it?
2.
How many neutrons inside it?
2.
So total mass number is how much?
4.
Atomic number is how much?
2.
So it is which element?
Helium.
Okay. Now out of this, if this has come out,
yes.
This was the nucleus of americium.
144 and 83.
Excellent. So number of neutrons will become 144, number of protons will become
93.
Very good. So which option is it?
C.
C. So let's make a note. 1C. Now do the second question, all of you, please.
A. Sir.
A.
One is done, so I will
scroll
over. It's okay. It's all getting recorded. If anything, you refer back to the video and do. You have to rush. You can refer back to the video, pause it, and copy the question if you want at a later time. It's all getting recorded. So you won't miss anything. Which nucleus is produced with
americium
241? So again, 241 minus. Wait, who is?
A.
Wait, wait. One at a time, please. Kiraz, if alpha particle is emitted, 241 will change to?
42.
No. From 241, what should you, how much should you subtract?
4.
4. So 237. Now these two options have 237. But number of protons will decrease by?
93.
Please don't speak out of turn.
So,
I am picking one student at a time.
No, but this is saying emits an alpha particle.
Yeah, so alpha particle has come out. So from inside the nucleus, alpha particle came out carrying away 2 protons and 2 neutrons.
Okay.
So whatever is left behind will have 93 protons.
Yes.
So it's A. Agreed? So what was question number 1?
Alpha particle.
Question number 1 was C2 is A. What?
Alpha particle does not have to be a part of helium always.
You are not getting the point. Alpha particle is a collection of 2 protons and 2 neutrons. That is same as a helium nucleus. Any whenever there is a collection of 2 protons, it's called helium. A collection of 1 proton is called hydrogen. 3 protons is called lithium. 8 protons is called oxygen. Lithium has 3 protons. Hydrogen 1, helium 2, lithium 3.
So hydrogen has only 1 proton.
Yes.
Then what will
happen? Hydrogen has 1 proton. So what do you mean what will happen?
The low alpha particle will be reduced.
Of course not. Out of 1 proton, how can you create? How can a 1 proton object emit 2 protons
that
and 2 neutrons?
That is the only element that cannot emit.
What?
That is the only element of the periodic table that cannot emit.
Alpha particle is emitted only by radioactive elements. Radioactive elements are elements which have very large number of protons.
More
than iron.
Americium
has how many protons?
Is it radioactive?
Of course, that's why it's emitting alpha particle.
So which elements are radioactive?
Those elements which are much heavier, like around 90 plus 80 plus protons, they are radioactive.
Whose nucleus is?
You can have other elements also radioactive with lesser number of protons, but they may have more number of neutrons, like that. You don't need to have a big list in your memory that which is radioactive, which is not. Whichever is radioactive, it can be emitting radiations only of 3 types. Those 3 types are called as alpha, beta, gamma, which I want to explain. Okay? Wait, you are in the middle of an explanation, don't ask a question. So there are 3 types of radiations. by which a nucleus will become more stable, alpha, beta, d and gamma. So last class I explained alpha, so we did two questions to recap as a warm up activity. Now let's continue with today's topic.
So I didn't go to the first question.
What?
So then should the answer be 142 and 93?
In the first question from it, look here, it's 146 neutrons. Avyukt, this is not mass number. So IGCSE will trick you in this way, they will, you have to read the question carefully. In this question, this is not mass number, this is neutron number. Whereas in the second question, it was mass number, not neutron number. Okay? So we'll come back to this after finishing beta and gamma decay.
So mass number is the number of neutrons and protons
in the nucleus? Yes, mass number is the total number of neutrons plus protons inside the nucleus.
So what is the full form of NP?
Full form of?
NP.
Neptunium.
NP.
NP is Neptunium.
So what is the symbol for gamma?
I'll tell you 1 minute. I want to open notepad, it's not working.
No, see the liquid.
Okay, so three types of decay. So alpha decay is clear to everybody? Naman? Naman?
Naman? Yes, sir. Three types of decay.
Alpha decay is 4, 2. So you have some nucleus, say X, which has mass number 8 and proton number. Okay, proton number is called as Z. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Z is the number of protons. A is the number of protons plus neutrons. Clear? So, if this emits an alpha particle, then what will be left over will be X A minus 4. Because this totally 4 mass number has come out. So from A, 4 will be reduced. Vikas, are you listening?
Yes, sir.
And the number of protons will become Z minus 2. So this is the nuclear reaction. So when you have the balance in nuclear reaction in which alpha decay has happened, this is how you do the balancing. Okay? So now let's go on to beta decay, gamma decay, and then we'll come back to the worksheet. So now next is beta decay. Let me do it here. Now beta decay is of two types. This is the Greek symbol for beta. You have beta plus decay and you have beta minus decay. Okay, two types. Beta plus decay, beta minus decay. Beta minus is the other name for an electron, typical electron. Beta plus is the other name for a positron. If I introduce a new term immediately, don't pounce on me by asking that what is this, what is it. It's obvious that if I introduce a new term, I will be explaining it. Be patient.
So beta minus is an electron.
Yes.
So is it type of alpha?
I'm explaining. Beta minus is an electron. Beta plus is the antiparticle of an electron. Now I'm introducing another new term, antiparticle. Don't ask what is antiparticle, I will tell you. Wait.
Is there some quantum mechanics?
Wait. So positron is antiparticle of electron. Now it turns out that in this universe, every single particle which is created has an antiparticle. Bags under the table or down on the floor. Shivansh, I don't see notebooks for some of you. I'm teaching some concepts, you need to be writing it, right? So positron is antiparticle of electron. So every particle has an antiparticle. That means you will ask me what is the antiparticle of a proton which has positive charge. It is called as antiproton. It will have a negative charge. Except for opposite charge, everything else is identical. repeating it. So just as you have a hydrogen atom consisting of a proton with positive charge with electron revolving around it, you could have an equally, say, exactly identical atom but with opposite.
So every particle has an antiparticle.
Yes. So you could have an atom which is consisting of antiproton with positron revolving around it.
Antiproton or
antiproton would have a negative charge, positron would have a positive charge. It would be exactly same setup.
Antiproton
has the mass of a proton. Electron has the mass of an electron, which is 1386 times less than charge of a proton. Antiproton has negative charge, electron has negative charge, that is the common thing.
Yes, sir.
But the mass is 1386 times less. Antiproton, proton, they are called, they are classified. See, listen, you have learned periodic table,
yes, sir,
which classifies elements into groups,
yes, sir,
and periods.
Yes, sir.
Like that, it turns out that the particles which this universe is made up of is not just proton, neutron, electron, which you have learned till now, but there are hundreds of different particles which can be created. And those particles are created when you bombard two particles with lot of energy. So each new particle which is created, scientists have made a note of their properties, and then they looked at the patterns in the properties of these particles, and they came up with a classification of particles also. Like you have baryons, mesons, leptons. So this is an entirely new branch of physics, which is called particle physics, which you will learn later on in IB. Not now. Yes.
So can positrons and antiprotons exist in our universe?
Yeah, they can. They can, but the first one catch is, if a particle meets its antiparticle, so suppose right now Lorentz is made up of particles, right? All the atoms of Lorentz's body are having a proton, nucleus consisting of protons and neutrons with electrons orbiting it. Suppose from some parallel universe, another Lorentz of antiparticles comes up. Okay, when you look at both of them, they will look identical. You can't differentiate. Are you getting it?
Yeah.
Only thing is, because instead of a proton, he has antiproton, instead of electron, he has positron. So you can't distinguish them. So suppose they meet in outer space and they shake hands. That means what? Then what will happen is?
So both will be destroyed and energy will be.
Yes, you'll be converted into pure energy. Instantly, it's the biggest explosion you can think of.
So when antiparticles meet with its opposites.
Yes, when a particle meets its antiparticle, they will undergo instant annihilation. That means they will be converted into pure energy, 100% conversion, so, no loss. That means what formula you will use?
E equals mc square
formula you will use.
So what form of energy?
Pure energy, electromagnetic radiation. Energy in its purest form is electromagnetic wave. Once again, let's do this calculation. What's your mass? What's your mass?
60 kg.
So 60 kg. So if Lorentz meets his anti-Lorentz, so the total mass which will be converted to energy will be 120 kg into c square. 3 into 10 to the power 8 the whole square. So 120 into 9 into 10 to the power 16 joules of energy will be released. I am sure this is extraordinarily huge amount. It can destroy the planet, definitely. It will pulverize the planet.
So,
yes.
So number one, so this is basically antimatter, right?
Yeah. Positron is antimatter.
Yes. Okay. And secondly, why is it that only one type of matter exists in this universe and a very small quantity of antimatter?
Okay, so let me answer that first. So this is one of the mysteries of the universe even now, and one possible explanation is that out of billions, see, actually if a particle is created from, see, initially there was just energy, okay? During the creation of the universe, during the Big Bang, when space as well as time got created, there was only energy. From energy, one second, I'm explaining one question here. If you ask another question, I will finish. So from energy, when matter is created, it has to be created in pairs, matter, antimatter, together. Then only the symmetry is maintained. So there should be equal amounts of matter and antimatter.
Yeah.
But right now in our universe, we don't find any antimatter, we only find matter. Agreed? So the mystery is answered by one possible explanation is that
is anti-universe.
Out of every million particles which are created, and correspondingly a million antiparticles were also created, but there was a slight asymmetry. Like out of, say, every million, one extra particle was created, something like that. So, due to this, finally, all the million and million particles will annihilate with million antiparticles, but this one particle is left over. Like this, out of all the collections, now we are having this matter. This is one hypothesis. It's not very convincing. So, these are all pending mysteries. We have a lot of unsolved mysteries in our physics theory. These are extra topics, not prepared for exam. If you are confused, leave it.
You tell me what's P minus.
P bar, this is called P bar. Listen, if I put a dash above the particle's symbol, it means it's antiparticle. Okay? So, if neutron is a particle, anti-neutron would be like this. But neutral particles, the antiparticles will also be neutral. So, how are they different from each other in some way which we don't understand right now? Okay?
Anti-neutron.
Yeah. If neutron meets anti-neutron, it will become pure energy. That's all.
Sir, what do you call P bar?
Anti-proton.
Sir, what are the characteristics of anti-proton?
Its charge is negative, that's the only difference. Everything else is same.
Okay. Sir, how do we create a matter like a lab or something?
So, in a particle accelerator, if you make two particles collide with very high energies, okay, then whatever extra energy it carries, that energy is used up according to this formula, and the mass of this much value can be
created. What is C?
C is the speed of light through vacuum, which is 3 to 10 to the power 8 meter per second.
Speed of light vacuum.
Yes. So, the more energy you give to the particles when they collide, after collision, more particles are created. It's like you take these two marker pens and collide them with such high energy that out of this, let us say a mass equivalent, say 1 kg mass is popping out. Actual mass is 50 grams. Two 50 gram particles collide and out of the collision 1 kg particle comes out. So it seems to, it doesn't follow conservation of mass, it's conservation of energy. The energy carried by these 50 gram particles is so huge, part of that energy is converted into mass. So it doesn't violate conservation of energy, but it violates conservation of mass.
E is energy.
Okay, so now let's get into the detail of what is beta decay.
So what is a positron?
It is the antiparticle of an electron. I told you.
So it is a positive electron.
Yes. Okay, now let's understand what is this beta decay. You have to note down the equation because in your
books, we use only
the exact equation is not given. But they just tell you the superficial.
So we use antiparticle equation.
Better to know, it makes sense to you.
Sir, we use antiparticles to create a lot of energy.
We don't use it to create energy right now. We just create few antiparticles in the acceleration particle accelerators by spending billions of dollars to do the experiment. And they will interact with the matter and become energy again. You can't store antimatter. Because how will you store antimatter?
They will store it in a vacuum.
So it will reach this boundary of the vacuum and hit the matter.
The vacuum will mass.
Yeah. Boundary of the vacuum will have some mass.
So and it's an electron. So that's why it'll just go through the
antimatter of any particle you can create, but they will move and hit the matter at some time. Okay. In that novel, what is the novel?
Angels and Demons.
Angels and Demons, he creates an antimatter bomb.
Yes, that's it.
Okay. Read it, it's fun. Okay, now, alpha decay is done when a nucleus wants to immediately reduce its protons as well as neutrons and become stable. Okay? All this happens when there is excess neutrons and protons, right?
Angels and Demons blast.
No blasting, it just emits and stays, becomes a new element. So now, beta decay, suppose the nucleus has extra protons, in order to reach stability, it has to decrease the number of protons. Sure. Suppose the nucleus wants to decrease the total number of protons in its nucleus. Okay?
Total number of protons.
Yeah. So the proton number has to decrease. Firas, eyes on the board. So proton can change into a neutron.
How?
But then proton has a positive charge. neutron has zero charge. So the charge has to be conserved always. It's a law of nature. The charge has to be conserved in every reaction. So the charge is carried by this positron. Are you getting it?
Yes.
So now the charge is conserved, but then there is another concept called momentum which has to be conserved in every nuclear reaction. You won't go into the details. That rule requires that there has to be a neutrino which is emitted. Neutrino is another particle which has very, very small mass, very small mass, almost zero mass. And zero charge. What is it, Naman?
Neutrino.
I just introduced a new name, a new baby which is created. If a baby is born, we give a name. You don't have to panic and get confused about it. It's as simple as giving a name to a new stranger who came into the world. Neutrino.
Very small, almost zero, many zero.
This neutrino has almost zero mass. Initially, people thought it has no mass. Right now, around million or trillion neutrinos are passing through your body from the sun. From the sun, around million, billion neutrinos are bombarding and passing through your body, but you don't feel anything.
So it's not hitting us
here. It is hitting and passing through. It doesn't impact much because it has no charge. Its mass is also almost zero, so you don't feel anything. So in Japan, they have built this experiment.
So what's the difference between
them?
Neutron
and a neutrino. Neutron's mass is how much?
So a neutron is a particle.
Its mass is close to mass of a proton.
Yes, sir.
But neutrino's mass is almost zero. Okay? So they are a different family of particles.
So what's that N0 in the frame?
I don't need to be in the frame. Board is in the frame, right?
So what is N0?
N0 refers to neutron having zero charge. Here I am representing the charge. So neutrino also has zero charge. You don't even mention it here. Yes?
So is a neutrino like the same as a ray?
It's a particle.
So is light a particle or is it like a...
Light doesn't have any mass. Because it travels at speed of light. Light travels at speed of light. Anything which travels at speed of light cannot have mass according to special theory of relativity.
So neutrino doesn't travel at speed of light?
No. Neutrinos can have speeds of any value, but not speed of light.
So tell me one thing, when proton is decayed by emitting neutron and
not emitting neutron, by changing into a neutron. These are the emitted particles.
By changing into a neutron and a positron, by emitting a positron, won't the electron and positron meet and then
they... Yeah, they will. If there is any electron, once the positron is coming out of the nucleus, it meets the electron and becomes energy. But then when you use E equal to mc squared, the energy is small only. Because mass of electron is 10 power minus 31 kg. That's all, the energy of the positron combining. So what will happen? One positron will eat up one electron, that's all. One electron missing will not make any difference to the universe.
Nothing else will
happen. No.
So
you have how many electrons? Have you any idea?
So then why did you say that it will be
What?
He said the world gets destroyed if one electron meets any particle and
all. Not one electron. Mass of longer, I said. 60 kg mass. Convert it. If 60 kg of matter meets 60 kg of antimatter and gets destroyed, then the energy release is huge. One electron destroying one and one positron, how will that energy be huge?
So basically not a big energy.
Yes.
Yes.
So now how will you remember this reaction?
What we say was Japan experiment.
So in Japan, they have made many experiments which are like very expensive and very extraordinarily huge just to detect neutrinos which are...
So they aimed a neutrino emitter or something?
No, details, you can Google it up later or email me, I will send you the details.
So there is one experiment where they aimed a neutrino emitter at the Earth and after, at the Earth, and on the other side of the globe they had a...
Yeah, that's why it's very difficult to detect neutrinos.
And detector, and they're like one in every few million or something.
Yes. Okay, coming back to this. So the logic for remembering this reaction is, if you have a proton, it is going to change into neutron. Nothing else is left. And then the charge has to be conserved, so the positron will be there, because positron has positive charge. And then you need to have here either a neutrino or an anti-neutrino. These are the two options. Vinas.
Okay.
Yes. So here, since this is an antiparticle, this will be a particle. That's the rule. If here instead of electron you have positron, Shivansh. Okay. Shivansh and Firas, please. You keep getting switched off. Alternately. Can you please consciously make efforts to stay focused? I can feel your mind drifting off. Focus. One second. If this is antiparticle, this has to be particle. Okay? Now next question I will ask to Shivansh. So in this is called electron plus is beta, beta plus is positron, right? So what will we call this, Shivansh? Will you call this beta plus decay or beta minus decay? Since this decay involves a beta plus, what do you think we should call it? If a reaction is involving beta plus particles, will we call it beta minus decay or beta plus decay?
Beta
minus decay. If you are writing an essay about zebras, will you call it zebras or horses? So tell the answer to the hopeless question. So if I ask the same question twice, you will change your answer. If you write an essay about zebras, will you call it zebras or horses? Second time I'm asking.
So zebras or breed of horses?
I didn't know the answer, right? You will be giving the
reply. Now also I'm not giving the answer, I'm not giving the reply. Tell me your answer. Just tell the answer.
So tell it confidently. Why do you feel so much of doubt?
It's going to be beta plus decay. Now Shivansh, you will tell me what will be the beta minus decay. It's all logic and common sense. Shivansh, come on. If you start with a proton and it becomes neutron, it's beta plus decay. What is the other possibility?
And
you start with a neutron, what can it change into?
Can't we call it positive decay?
Wait.
Proton.
It will change into proton. What charge will a proton have?
Plus one.
Only Shivansh will tell now. What will it have? Because you know, I'll ask you when I think I have a question which you don't know. Okay, what should be emitted? This has zero charge, this already has
what
plus.
What is that DHCF, sir?
Huh?
What is that DHCF,
neutrino?
That's all, he gets switched off in between. Every 5 minutes he will switch off. I can't repeat it now, you watch the video. Okay.
So E minus.
If Shivansh, quick charge, 0 plus, if charge on the left hand side is 0, charge on the right hand side should also be 0. So should you have an electron or a positron here?
Yeah.
So this equation implies that
what
I did?
That
should be something with
the
0 charge.
Something with the 0 charge. If you have only 0 charge here, what will be the net charge in the right hand side?
So,
please, Dr. I am trying to make him understand. You need to be patient. Wait. Shivansh, stand up. Others, be quiet. I didn't ask your help. Please wait. Shivansh. Left hand side is zero charge. Right hand side should be how much charge?
Zero.
Right now, how much charge does it have?
Negative.
Right now, how much charge does it have?
One
positive. So, I need what?
Negative.
So, what can we use? Electron or positron?
Electron,
not
electron. So, what is
the
positive or negative? Electron.
Electron has what charge?
One negative.
Now, is electron a particle or antiparticle?
Particle.
Particle. If this is particle, what should the neutrino type be? Should it be a particle neutrino or antiparticle neutrino? Antiparticle. Clear?
So, why?
That is again one more conservation thing, which you don't have to get into it. Listen, yaar, you are dealing with, if I tell all the facts, you will say I am telling too many facts. So I am just trying to keep it at a balance. So this is called anti-neutrino.
So why is that?
You need to conserve something called as electron number.
So it's an equation like proton is equal to neutron plus electron plus neutrino. Like, so when you do, when you
achha, it is swap the side.
Yeah. So equal sign agar se laga do, to fir neutrino ka kya hoga?
Neutrino opposite.
Positive to waise hi hai.
And
the electron when it goes at it, its charge gets flipped. Right. So its antiparticle is electron. Neutrino, when neutrino it goes the other side, its antiparticle is anti-neutrino.
Yes. One by one. Yes, Kapila.
Neutrino and anti-neutrino.
The difference is neutrino is a particle, anti-neutrino is its antiparticle. If these two combine, they become pure energy. Both have negligible mass, both have zero charge. Okay? But there is some property which is different which we don't understand right now.
So this is beta minus all the neutrons.
So this is beta minus dk.
This is true with all the neutrons.
Yes, all neutrons can change into proton in this way. This is beta plus dk. Yes,
sir. What do you
want
to do? Any difference between them?
Sir, do you understand the property of antiparticle?
Guys, one at a time. Yes.
Beta minus dk.
Louder.
That no charge there. There's a positive charge into charge. Why is there anti-neutrino?
See. In every beta decay, there will be either a neutrino or an anti-neutrino. Okay? The reason is, in order to conserve momentum, how, why, all that you won't understand now. You need to learn particle physics. In IB, you will understand. In IB, SCOM, SCCOM, you can learn the more detailed answers. Okay? Now, you just need to know that the neutrino is produced when proton becomes neutron, which is beta plus decay. Anti-neutrino is producing beta minus dk. In order to, instead of memorizing it blindly, I gave you one logic to figure out when neutrino will be produced, when anti-neutrino will be produced. If positron is produced, it's already antiparticle, so neutrino has to be particle. If particle is produced, then antiparticle will be produced.
So if antiparticle is antiparticle,
so that they become pure.
Nothing will happen. Yes.
So you said that all the dynamic equilibrium in a particle, that is that a proton, what is known as a neutron.
Okay, wait. So that question I think someone else also spoke about. Let me clarify. Inside a nucleus, proton seems to be changing to neutron, neutron changes to proton, like that the book said, so I told you. But if they have followed this kind of reaction, we would have been observing these particles getting emitted, which we don't. So I think that dynamic equilibrium is different mechanism which we don't know right now. But this is a permanent change. If a proton permanently changes to neutron, we can detect it by seeing these positrons coming out of the nucleus. If a neutron changes permanently to a proton, we can see it by these electrons coming out of the nucleus. These electrons are coming out of the nucleus, not from the shells of the atom. Please understand, these are nuclear electrons. Obviously, electrons don't exist inside the nucleus, they are just created during the decay. Are you getting it? Inside the nucleus, there are no electrons, but it is coming from inside the nucleus. So, what does it mean? It means it's created in that instant. Yes?
Since matter exerts gravity on each other, so anti-matter would logically exert anti-gravity on another.
No. Matter, antimatter, everything exerts gravity only. There is no anti-gravity.
Listen.
Just because the name is antimatter doesn't mean the gravitational effect is opposite. No.
Only the charge is opposite, na?
Yes, charge is opposite for charged particles. For neutral particles, some other property is opposite, which we don't know.
Sir, tell me one property. One property, please.
Charge. I don't know. Even if it is discovered, I don't know what to call the property. Yes.
So if we don't know the properties of a neutrino and an anti-neutrino, like the difference,
yes.
Then how do we know which one is the neutrino and which one is not? The mass is the same.
Good question. So right now I also don't know.
Sir,
Okay. But we all know that from this reaction, whatever particles are emitted, it has to be neutrino.
So
in this reaction, it has to be antineutrino. If you have a pool of neutrinos in one jar and pool of a collection of antineutrinos in another jar, how to distinguish it? We don't know.
So the question is,
so you can research it. Yes.
So then, if we have two elements, which one of them has like it does beta decay, positive beta decay, one the negative beta decay. So when both of them happen together, then there will be a lot of energy released.
Yes.
So does that happen? Do we use that?
We don't have. We are not in a position to collect enough of matter and enough of antimatter. These are just few particles of antimatter. You can't. You don't have grams of antimatter being collected. Just few particles.
So
can
this happen in one element?
Okay, Naman. These are like extra questions, extension questions. You may need. We discuss later. We need to be focusing on the syllabus.
Beta plus decay में positive electron and neutrino decay emitted. So in beta plus decay positive electron and neutrino decay emitted.
Yes.
So in the beta minus decay negative electron and anti neutrino will emit.
Yes. Yes. Okay, now the last type of decay. Wait, so now the last type of decay is gamma decay. In a gamma decay, this is the gamma decay.
So
you don't have to tell me about that. So in a gamma decay, whatever element you have, X, A, Z, it will continue to remain X, A, Z. So then what is the change? The change is in the energy which was present in the nucleus. The energy, in the form of photon is emitted. Photon refers to the packet of energy which is electromagnetic waves. So if there is a gamma decay, nothing changes in the nucleus. Only energy becomes lesser, that's it.
So what's a photon?
Photon is a one packet of energy.
Huh?
A packet of energy. Energy is a wave.
Yes, sir.
But you can think of energy also as packets, quantities. Like money. Like money, yeah, small unit of energy. Like money. You can have smallest unit of money as 1 rupee. Huh. It can be given to others in terms of rupees, 1 rupee, 10 rupee, 100 rupee, 500 rupee. Like that, energy can be given in form of electromagnetic waves. In small quantities.
1 photon, 2 photon, 3 photon.
Yes.
So this is the smallest unit of energy.
Yes. Photon is the smallest unit of energy. And just like smallest unit of currency can be in many denominations.
Yes, sir.
1 rupee, 2 rupee, 5 rupee, 10 rupee, like that.
So can we do this?
Photon can also be 5,000 rupee photon, 1 rupee photon, 10 rupee photon, like that. It depends on the frequency of the wave.
Sir, how many is this 1 photon?
That's all. It depends. It's like asking. 10,000 rupees has how many notes? 10,000 rupees will have how many notes? Will depend on whether you are talking about 100 rupee note or 500 rupee note or 1 rupee coin.
Oh.
If you are asking how many 1 rupee coins, it will be 10,000 1 rupee coins.
So question.
If you are asking how many 100 rupee notes, it will be 1,000 100 rupee note.
Sir, can we do this tomorrow in detail?
Alpha, beta, gamma is done. Now I will give you practice questions.
Sir, gamma I didn't understand.